Is there such a thing as a universal language
beyond words?
How can I show you who I am without fear of me getting you wrong or of you getting me wrong? What is the truth of you? What is the truth of me? We're going to explore together, and the word we used last week was experiment. That means you can try things and you don't know what's going to happen, but we have a safe space and we've got friends among us. We can try things and say things and show things to each other, which maybe nobody's actually tried before, and we'll see what works and keep it. And we'll see what doesn't work and let it go. Yeah? The X-ray eyes idea is all about looking at people and trying to work out, how are they feeling? Who are you really? What story have you got to tell me? And not just telling each other things, but showing each other things using performance. That's the language we're going to use. In this place, which we're going to call, in our X-ray, we're calling it the centre. Yeah. You can show things, you can tell things, and you can make experiments, and there's no such thing as a right or wrong answer. Does that sum it up? Is that enough of a beginning for you? Well, one of the things that happens in the centre is plenty of games and exercises and things.
Yasmina.
Yasmina.
Jadid.
Jadid.
Mohan.
Mohan.
Mahi. Mahi.
Ed.
Ed.
Anik.
Amit. You said it really beautifully. Tell me again that thing that you just said.
You were doing a movement to show how you were feeling.
That's all we needed to do. It was anybody in the world can say, I can't tell you, but I can show you. We're showing how we feel by our movements. This could look like I'm thinking up a really awful thing to do to you. Or I'm trying to think of the right thing to do. How can you tell which is which? It's just a question. I don't know the answer. How are we going to find the answer? I'm going to show you X-ray eyes. Exactly. Okay.
In my title, by the way, Emotional Literacy Victorian Style. To put it in Victorian terms, moral and religious education were considered to be important parts of any education, and moral and religious education involves cultivating children's better feelings and subjugating their bad passions. That's a standard Victorian way of thinking, and it amounts to something very like emotional literacy. It was a widespread view amongst educationalists that attention and affection must be engaged. You shouldn't just cram facts, facts, facts in a mechanical, rote learning way down the throats of infants, but you should engage their affections. That love and affection should engage the interest of children, and when that has been achieved, they will then learn much better. Again, a standard view that's put these days in terms of emotional literacy.
X-ray eyes, at the moment, consists of 7 movements, and I'm just teaching you them plain. I'm not saying it's good, and I'm not saying it's bad. They're just moves, okay? The first move is this. Arms out, palms straight up, that's right. The second move is this. You put one hand down, and you put hand over your mouth, okay? The next one is this. The next one is arms out to the front, palms up. This next one is like that. Number 6 is one that I want you to invent for yourself. And it's your own one, so they're all going to be different, yeah? Fantastic. And do you want to see what 7 is?
Yeah.
Yes.
Sometimes it's my favourite. 1, 2, 3. And there's lots of people who, if you say to them, do you want to do some performing with us? Do you want to go looking for some stories with us? They'll go, oh no, don't ask me. I can't do drama. Don't look at me. I'd rather not do it. Thank you very much. We want to be able to say, yes, you can. Yes, you can. We've got this alphabet, and it's called X-ray eyes, and you just need to learn it, and then everybody will find themselves in a story. I love this moment best of all. Are you ready, people? We're going to have a little bit of practice. You will find yourself in a story any second now. Do you believe me?
Yes.
Thank goodness I've got away with it so far. 3, 2, 1, go. Now we can use them to X-ray other people. That's what we're going to do next week. We're going to use them to look at real life. Do you feel up to that?
Yeah.
So you just need to remember them. It's a little toolbox, and now everybody in this room has equal ownership.
Two fundamental errors that a wise person in the 18th century would have detected in this project. Error one, that a child has something intelligent to say about emotion. In the 18th century, children had nothing intelligent to say about emotions. Error number two, you don't get to create your own picture of the emotion. Emotion is actually about reason. It sounds counterintuitive, but for the 18th century, that's what they thought. Emotions could be rationally understood, had to be rationally understood in order to be correctly understood. And you don't get to decide how they're depicted. Nature gives to each emotion a proper outward form, a bodily picture of what the emotion looks like. Anger looks like this, terror looks like this, guilt looks like that. Imagine, if you will, an illustrated dictionary of emotions.
This is the center, and it's a place anyone can find anything. And you just stand up with your partner and you hold it, and we try and find the story.
And all of them are like true stories. Like,
all of them are true. Mm-hmm.
All of them are true.
So for 2 minutes more, the center's open.
One, two, three.
Go!
Oh. Great, and freeze it. Okay, what's the...
Is that Jed is carrying, like, Ed's pet, and it's dead? And
it's so, picture it. Okay, what's there? What kind of animal is it?
A cat.
Okay, and if that is a talk bubble, and if that is a think bubble, okay, this character is saying,
I've brought your dead meerkat.
and he can't speak because he's got his hand over his mouth, so he's thinking,
I'm going to kill you.
And he's really thinking, what's he really thinking?
Oh no.
Oh no.
Yeah, he's going to kill you.
Yeah. So he's saying, I brought your dead meerkat, but he's thinking, oh no. This person's looking, and they can see their dead meerkat, okay? Can you show me what is going on inside this character right now? Is it this? Is it this? Is it this? Can you show me by coming up and standing around him? Yeah. As many as you like. And freeze it once you're up there. Another one. Another one. Good. Another one. Ooh, last one.
Everybody
okay.
Got up.
There's a dead meerkat, and there's you, and here's everything inside that person. And I want to hear the sound until I click again. Here it comes. Keep a freeze, keep a freeze, keep a freeze. Well done, relax, give yourselves a round of applause. But do you see what I meant by x-ray there? Everybody knows that feeling. And it's one of those moments you see that I really worry what's going to happen when one of my pussycats dies. And I have no idea what I'm going to feel like, but I bet you I feel 10 things at the same time. And some of the big moments in your life, you feel 10 things at the same time. Did you notice not everybody was doing this?
Not everyone is doing this kind of boo-hoo and weeping. There's one girl who's standing there like this, looking very aggressive and angry. I'm doing a much bigger project on the history of weeping, but the point about grief and weeping is a very simple one, which is that it's a great illustration of how there isn't a one-to-one relationship, even between quite simple emotions and quite simple expressions. If you see someone weeping, if you don't know the context, if you just see a tear running down someone's cheek, you haven't the faintest idea about their emotional state. They could be angry, they could have just chopped an onion, they could be grieving, they could be happy, they could be like me, somebody who's just terribly sentimental and weeps at almost anything. So on its own, it doesn't really tell you anything at all. And equally, if you're grieving, it's not at all guaranteed that you will weep. You could slam a car door in grief just as much as you could weep. So that's a straightforward way of saying that whatever is going on, there's not a simple one-to-one correlation.
Which one am I doing?
Number three.
And I can kind of hold it up Do you see what I mean?
I chose this one because I like the way he looks a bit funny if you look at it in a different angle, and it showed me that one action can mean if you look at it another way, it looks like something else.
I picked this action because it looks like somebody's really hurt, and that's it. I like the way it's showed because I like to do this. It reminds me of doing ballet.
It looks a bit simple to make. And if you look at it, it's like somebody is blaming someone else for doing something bad.
It looks like it's screaming. And I've learned that different moves make different expressions.
Now, the word expression also has this meaning of squeezing something out. When you express milk, or when you express oil out of something, or juice. So the vomiting model is the idea that the expression is a squeezing out of something that's inside. It's a kind of psychic vomit. So that my face and my body brings out what is inside. To illustrate this idea, there's a wonderful bit of animation created by the children at Osmani School. We're going to see a slightly longer version of this film at the very end of the session today. But this is just to... I mean, I was very delighted to find out that the kids had come up with this as one model of what it is to feel emotional. There we go. That is entitled Nauseous versus Nauseous.
The idea behind the X-ray eye template is that it's a cultural intervention, really, in a school, in a whole school. And you take the idea and you take a core group of children and say, what do you think of this? This isn't a performance, this isn't a script, this really is a recipe. And the ingredients are other people and what's inside them and how they feel and what they make of the games and the exercises and the things that we've already discovered that we like and we're good at working with and we're good at imparting them. We've found our own style of doing that, of transmitting what we've got. But now, this is what happens when you take that idea and attempt, and today is the first attempt, to allow it to cascade is one word, right through a morning. There is a question, and the question is both an artistic one and a curricular one, an organisational one. Where is the space? I think this is my main question. Where is the space in the day? Where is the space in the school? Where is the space in the teacher's timetable? Where is the space in the national curriculum? And where's the space in every single individual child that genuine, free emotional expression can be allowed to take place? Where is that space? Okay, where are we going?
Places, everyone.
I have absolutely no idea where the gym is. And we're lost. Hello there.
Hello.
Are you coming to play? We're starting off again. Oh, nobody's here yet, anyway. What's happening in the space? Here we have, at the moment, in order, the seven movements that we call the takeaway of X-ray eyes, which in all its possible combinations, including dance combinations, April Fool joke combinations, guessing game combinations, playground game combinations, and focused dramatic explorations. In all of those ways that it might be used, which are up to the child, this you will see percolating through all the spaces in the school today.
One, two, three, four, five, six,
everyone in the line.
Seven.
Takeaway is the form. Then it is informed by emotion, music, meaning, and connections. I'd like to read from something called The Body Speaks. Emotion is actually experienced in the body, not the mind. The mind can trigger emotion, but it is the flesh that feels it. When you are nervous, it is the hands that get sweaty, the mouth that dries, the bladder that suddenly needs to empty, the stomach that fills with butterflies, and the heart that races. And that is why we need to get the body engaged when working with emotion. It is the real site of our emotional lives.
Okay, what are they feeding? This guy is feeding that angry.
Yeah. Sleepy, jealous, angry, frustrated, devastated, annoyed, shocked, surprised.
Anxious.
What does it say? Anxious.
Anxious.
Sad. Shocked. Wow. Flabbergasted. I don't even know how to spell that, actually.
The pictures were particularly successful, I think. It's quite an easy game, and I think the kids of different ages could look at them. And with some of them, I talked to them about these are historical images, and they're from 200 or 300 years ago, and they seem quite interested in that. And others, it's just like a really simple game. There's a face, and you've got to say, what are they feeling?
Shocked. Shocked and sad.
I'm interested in the history of the expression of the emotion, and one sort of consistent tradition through the centuries has been the idea that there's this universal language, that all of us, all human beings, have the same way of expressing certain human passions and emotions, and that you can read that through the face, not only the face but also the body. And I'm interested in the fact that there's this idea that there's this universal language of emotion, but that it seems to change over time. It changes from one place to another.
So you've got sad and smelly, and what else?
And disgusting.
And something I've always wanted to do is to put some of the historical images, which is what I had today, from books of physiognomy and science of expression, and put them to people in the 21st century, kids or adults, and say, what do you think this face shows?
Evil. Do you think number one's evil? Why do you think people said that? Evil, bad guy, sinister. So they're kind of, he's got, closing his eyes. Because some people might say he looked happy because he's, you know, isn't he smiling? But he looks evil at the same time. Yeah, that's an interesting one.
Gummy.
I'm Jo, I'm the acting deputy and inclusion manager of Osmani School.
And what's today about for you?
Giving the children a chance to share what they've been doing over the last few weeks, but also just showing the children can be teachers as well as learners, and just celebrating all the wonderful things that they've been doing. It is very important. We want our children that grow up into adults that can share their feelings, that can say how they're, what's happening. We don't want children growing up to adults that aren't able to communicate. So it's important, so we give it the space that reflects that, I think.
A friend of mine once told me about chickens, okay? The fast freezing of chickens. And what they do, apparently, and I've got no evidence of this, but what they do is when they freeze them, they extract every bit of juice from them. Okay? And then at the very end of the process, before the consumer is about to buy it, it's been artificially injected with chicken flavouring. Okay? And the person at the end doesn't necessarily know the difference. My distinction is that in many ways schools are operating in the same way. And in schools, often we are squeezing out every bit of emotion, and the other area I'm interested in is creativity, and artificially adding it on at the end, in that we are moulding children into certain entities, and in some way we may be losing something that we actually didn't want to lose. And we've lost the space, and sometimes because we've lost the space for engaging children in their emotions, we have to add them at the end. Or on top, which doesn't sit so well. Forget all the league tables, forget all the exams. Two questions that drive everything. On the last day of school, when children walk out of the school gate, two questions you ask them. One, did they enjoy it? And two, do they want some more? Okay. And if those two were allowed to drive what goes on, then we might be able to recapture something that we've lost.
Does anybody know where we're going?
Yes, one lane.
Razia.
Tawana. We're going to a secondary school called Swinley to show them what we've been learning.
And what sort of things are you going to show them?
Expressing our feelings about talking.
And how do you do that?
By doing it with actions.
This is how you do a takeaway. We'll shout out a number and we'll also show you the movement, so we'd like you to copy us.
And how do you think they're going to respond?
I'm not really sure.
He's begging for money. He's like, he's laughing at him.
Look at this person who's laughing. I want to ask you, I wonder why. I wonder what that person is like inside. Now, I'm going to ask you, don't tell me, but... Okay. What's going on inside this person who's laughing? Come and show me. Okay, and another one. What's going on inside this person who's doing the laughing? Yeah? Have a think. It might not be a feeling that, yeah, yeah, good. There's the laughing. And we're saying behind the laughter is three images that do that. What would you call that? Aggression, anger,
Superior.
Yeah.
Superior.
I feel superior, so I laugh. Now, I didn't know I was going to see that, but now I've seen it. Do you see what I mean? Yeah. And I'd like to thank you all very, very much for helping us do that experiment today. It was a real eye-opener.
It was like connecting in a different way, proper random.
What sort of ways do you think?
It's like, when you think of connecting, you just think about speaking. It's like, yeah, how are you doing? But then connection as in, it's like we got closer to each other in a way that, I'm not sure.
We use physical action.
Yeah,
that's right. The way we use physical action, like people can read us, what we're feeling, but not exactly, but as like a picture in the head.
We have all the way through this process used performance itself as a language and as a mode of research, and what the children have done and what this series of seminars has done to the system is transform it into both a deeper and weightier, but also a more transferable, a more easily recyclable system. What happens at the beginning of any of these investigations is I start with a series of questions. Can children lead something which has hitherto, whatever the government might tell you, been rather a top-down requirement of teachers to deliver emotional literacy, to teach it as part of the national curriculum? Can children have a meaningful role in an empowered way to teach each other emotional literacy? And what the hell is emotional literacy anyway? The journey from this lecture theatre to Osmani Primary School and back again has had all kinds of dimensions, and inevitably that cycle of practice-based research has transformed the thing that is being made. The thing that is being made you've got in your hand, and at the end of this process a slightly transmogrified thing will be the thing that a teacher takes away, not just a drama teacher, a teacher who on the busiest day feels able to use this system and to delegate to children the ability to deliver the system, to explore their own feelings in any way that they want. I didn't expect that the question I would now have in my hand, and it has been given to me by the children, is where in the curriculum is this space for the child to express themselves as a human being through art or any other means? Where is it?
The Expression of the Emotions in Man and Animal, 1872. Now what I want is facts. Teach these boys and girls nothing but facts. Facts alone are wanted in life. Plant nothing else. Root out everything else. Everyday explanations for behaviour are offered increasingly in terms of emotional fragility. In an emotional state, explaining the emotional state, even one of the eared seals, the Otavia priscilla, which has very small ears, draws them back before making a savage rush at the legs of its keeper.
A sea maid sings on yonder reef, the spellbound seals drawn near. A lilt that lures beyond belief, mortals enchanted sheep on hillside, birds on bough.